Good evening and welcome, Reverend Divyanand Pranamataji of Sri Sharda Math, New Delhi. As you all are aware, Mataji is here today to share her thoughts and learning on the topic of bhakti. I now request Reverend Divyanand Pranamataji to enlighten us on bhakti.
Devim Ramakrishnam Jagadgurum Padapadme Tayoshritva Pranamami Muhur Muhur. My pranams at the feet of revered Adhyaksh Maharaj, all the revered Maharajs here, and namaskars to everyone. Really happy to be in Mumbai again, and really happy about the topic you have chosen for discussion here. Because, you know, somebody was telling me that, Didi, we have heard you speak so much on Vedanta and Yoga, but bhakti, then it came out of my mouth that, you see, something most precious to us, too much we don't talk about it. Bhakti is something truly precious. The most precious thing in life is bhakti. And you have chosen this topic for discussion, so I'm really delighted because you made me also think so much about bhakti and the science of bhakti, the art of bhakti. So that is something wonderful because Thakur bole diye chen, ja bolar, bhakti shambandhe. Thakur bol chen, bhakti shar. That is the essence of spiritual life. All of us are spiritual aspirants. We understand this very well. It is the power of emotion that becomes devotion to any path. Whether we are following the path of Jnana or Yoga, Raj Yoga or Karma Yoga, whatever it is, devotion is the main thing. It is by the power of devotion to that particular path that you can follow that path, you can go ahead in that path. Nothing can be done without devotion. So bhakti is the common factor in every path. It's not that bhakti is one marg and jnana is another. Bhakti is there in every marg. Bhakti is the common thing. Without bhakti, nobody can proceed. It is the power of emotion elevated to the level of devotion, applied to anything that gives us success in that path. And that is why bhakti is irreplaceable. We are all bhaktas, whether we are Vedantins, whether we are Advaitis, whatever we are all primarily bhaktas. Our Thakur arekta kotha bolchen, very significant, everything that Thakur has said, everything that there is to say about bhakti, Thakur has said. It's in the Kathamrit. That's the modern Bhagavat. Thakur says, jotokhon tini ami rekhechen, totokhon bhakti pothi bhalo. As long as we have this sense of I, it has not yet merged in the Lord. Bhakti is the way, obviously. You are in the dual mode. So, bhakti is the way. And then Thakur also says, this is the Yuga Dharma. This is the path for this age. You see, everywhere people are most sensitive to love and devotion. Even in outside India, you know, when they call us for lectures on Vedanta, that's what we call it. But when you go there, it's all bhakti. They want to hear about mother. They are steeped in mother, bhakti for mother. So bhakti is everything. And the avatar can see through the collective subconscious, the collective unconscious. So he knows what is the need of our people. And so he says bhakti is the Yuga Dharma. You see, this world loves the lover best. Isn't it? It shows where our heart lies. So how to cultivate this bhakti? This is the essential challenge before us. Bhakti will get us everything else that we require. Bhakti changes everything that needs changing. Bhakti transforms. Bhakti elevates. And bhakti is the fulfillment of life. You see, any other path, you have to go through certain things to get the goal. Isn't it? Some primary qualifications are there. And you're journeying somewhere, it appears like that. You have to satisfy this, then put an effort, do the practice, then go there towards the goal. In bhakti, right from the beginning, it's a path of joy and love. Love means joy, isn't it? So right from the beginning, the fruit is there right in the beginning. The path yields the fruit. So it is sulabha, it is called. It is easy path. It's an easy path, but not that easy. Because, you know, purifying emotion is not that easy. But it is a relatively easy path. And then it is Swayam Pramana, it is called. It is self-evident. Do we require any proof for love? Love is in every human heart. So nothing else is required. This emotion alone, raised to a particular level, can give us everything that we require in spiritual life. That is why bhakti has to be cultivated, and we must know certain laws about bhakti. We must know the actual signs of bhakti. This is what we will discuss here. And let us also discuss what Thakur says about bhakti, because that's the ultimate thing. He has said everything about bhakti. By definition, bhakti is, it is called sukshmataram anubhava rupam bhava vyutpatti karanam in our scriptures. It is of the nature of a subtle experience. It is a spiritual experience, because anything that transforms you, even if it's a dream, it's an experience because it has transformed you. So bhakti is transforming in effect. That is why sukshmataram anubhava rupam bhava vyutpatti karanam. It is the cause for the production of bhav in the human heart. It produces divine emotion. Divine emotion is all consuming. When bhakti is there, nothing else is required. You see, your own experience of bhakti, whenever you have felt devotion for the Lord, it is all fulfilling. Nothing more is required. You feel like that. In the Bhagavad Gita, very beautifully it is described, yam labdhva chaparam labham manyate nadhikam tataha yasmin sthitona dukhena gurunapi vichalyate. Bhakti is like that. When you have it, you feel enough. I don't want anything more than this. Praner shanti ashe. Isn't it? That is the nature of bhakti. It immediately yields its fruit. It doesn't appear like an effort. It appears natural. So by definition, bhakti is easy. Bhakti is a subtle vritti in your mind of the nature of spiritual experience, which brings bhav into your heart. Narada Bhakti Sutra's definition of bhakti is very beautiful. Sa parama prema rupa, it says. It is of the nature of supreme divine love. Bhakti's nature is like that. But one of the best definitions of bhakti I found in Madhusudan Saraswati's works. He was the great Advaitin, who wrote Advaita Siddhi to establish Advaita in his time. But he turned into a great bhakta and wrote Bhakti Rasayanam. There, how beautifully he spent a long part of his later years in Vrindavan, the great Advaitin. So he writes in his definition of bhakti, he says, Shrutasya Bhagavad Dharmad Dharavahikam Gataha Sarvesha Manovrittaya Bhakti Riti Abhidhiyate. It means, Shrutasya Bhagavad Dharmad, when you hear the glories of the Lord, the nature of the Lord, Dharavahikam Gataha Sarvesha Manovrittaya, which means if the mind melts away, Dravibhuta Chitta is a characteristic of bhakti. And the mind, whole mind melts, not one chitta vritti. Dharavahikam Gataha Sarvesha Manovrittaya. All the vrittis of the mind. In yoga, you are trying to transform one vritti after the other. In gnan, you are trying to, yes, again you are working with one vritti after the other. But in bhakti, it is a spontaneous flow of the entire mind with all its vritti samuha towards the Lord. It's a mighty river going to join the ocean. So bhakti is, that is why it is so transforming. It is the actual power of spiritual life. And then he says, Dharavahikam gata sarvesham manovrittaya sarvesham, all the vrittis of the mind. Because you see, when bhakti is in the mind, nothing else can be in the mind. It's not transformation of one chitta vritti after another. No such thing. The entire mind flowing towards the Lord. This is called bhakti, he says. And this kind of a love, if it enters into the human mind and enraptures the human heart, nothing more is required. That is the glory of bhakti. Once it is produced, it creates such a sanskar in the mind. You will never forget it. One episode of pure love and it's done. You are saved for life, you can say, because you will never forget it. Whatever is gets truly etched into our memory is an emotional experience. Please see this. And the very purest emotional experience towards the Lord, you will never forget it. It's like that prajna sanskar of jnan. You will never forget it. So this, the memory of this experience itself elevates human life. This is the power of divine emotion. So what the yogi gets through yoga, what the jnani gets through his jnan, the bhakta naturally gets through bhakti. Without effort, spontaneously, naturally. This is very beautifully described in Srimad Bhagavatam, you know, in the personality of Vishakha, that gopi, in one of the commentaries on Bhagavatam, it is there. I liked it so much, I wrote it down in my diary when I read it. This gopi, Vishakha, she was very close to Radha, Radharani. And so Sri Radha's bhav, she was able to take. What happened is, when she saw, one day she was moving about in Vrindavan, she saw Krishna sitting in a grove. In a kunj he was sitting. Now as soon as she saw Krishna, just observe this, because it's important for us to understand how bhakti, what bhakti does to you. As soon as her eyes fell on Krishna, immediately like this video camera, you know, it took in the picture. And immediately she shut her eyes so that nothing else enters. And that picture of Krishna went and settled in her heart. It started glowing there because she is not interested in anything but Krishna. That glowing image of Krishna so enraptured her mind that her mind went into the state of samadhi. Just by seeing that glowing image shining in her heart, the repository of all divine qualities, the very source of beauty, the very source of divinity shining in her heart, and her mind went into the state of samadhi. So what the yogi gets through all his discipline, she got by the power of her love. And that mind in samadhi, that bhav samadhi, that mind got so enthralled in that state, it could not remain mind anymore. It went and dissolved at Krishna's feet. So she transcended the mind. What the jnani aims at, transcending the mind, she attained that naturally again by the power of her love. What the yogi gains through all his discipline, the state of samadhi, she attained just by looking with love at the picture of Krishna established in her heart. And what the jnani gains by way of transcending his mind completely, nirvikalpa samadhi, what we say, that she got because her mind spontaneously went and dissolved at the feet of Krishna. This is how Vishakha attained the highest state of realization. You know, these gopis were not ordinary girls, cowherd girls. They were great rishis who had attained the highest jnana in their previous lives, but they thirsted for devotion. So they were born as gopis. Thakur says this, and that is why this experience, just by the power of her love. You see, first thing she did was, she shut her eyes to the world. If you want to establish the Lord in your heart, shut your eyes a little to worldly bhavs. Otherwise, you can't cultivate bhakti. And then concentrate on Him. This is what they are teaching us. If you concentrate on Him with love, samadhi will happen by itself. And you transcend the mind, because the mind, where will it merge? It will merge at His feet only. Love does everything if it is once generated in the heart. You know that beautiful incident when Uddhav reaches Vrindavan. What is his purpose? He wants to tell the gopis that the Krishna for whom you are crying so much, he is Sachidananda actually. He is Brahman. So you actually don't know. So I'm telling you, this Brahman, you see him as Brahman. Don't see him as that Gopal, as that cowherd boy who used to play with you. And then you won't be so unhappy. You won't be crying and all this. You will learn to merge into his real nature. He is Brahman. He went with this purpose. As soon as he saw them and the delightful weeping of those gopis, you know, they were delighted even in their viraha, because the viraha of the Lord produces great delight. They actually were one with him in heart. Just like this Vishakha, they had captured Krishna in his heart. So they can know no sorrow. But still that physical separation, due to that they were suffering viraha. As soon as he told them, you know, Krishna is actually Satchidananda. He is Brahman himself. So you merge your mind in Brahman, then you won't suffer this separation. That time, you know what they told him? The mind is already at his feet. In what else should I merge it into? It is already merged. There is no mind for us to give to your Satchidananda. It is already only at his feet. Thakur ki bolten, Gopi der sukshma sharir, Krishner paye paye ghurto. Their mind was at his feet all the time. They were already in the state of samadhi, samadhi-like state. So you see, bhakti naturally brings all this into our lives. You can grow in bhakti. If bhakti is not there, you cannot grow in anything. Neither in yoga, nor it's very obvious for those who practice spiritual disciplines. You cannot grow in jnan. Remember, the jnani was at some time a great bhakta. The paths crisscross. Looking at Swamiji's face, Thakur used to say, he appears to be a jnani, he is a bhakta. Can anybody have such a face without bhakti? The lives of the greatest jnanis you can see. Raman Maharshi, you know, later in life, when somebody used to sit, people have recorded in his reminiscences, when somebody used to read about the lives of great bhaktas, those Namalvas and Alvas, the great devotees of Lord Shiva, tears of joy, ecstatic joy would flow out of Raman Maharshi's eyes. They have written, it was a sight for the gods to see. Such a great jnani weeping like this. He was unconscious of it, but tears of joy would come out of his eyes. Every jnani is a bhakta. They are not two separate paths. Because you know, we have all these faculties, isn't it? We have the faculty of emotion, we have the faculty of thought, of will. How can you say bhakti marg and jnana marg? Everything has to be cultivated. Through the power of devotion, you cultivate all these faculties. So Swamiji recommended harmonization of yogas. Every yoga we are going to use in our journey towards the Lord. Every yoga. So the power of bhakti has to be understood. Ultimately, it is all bhakti. You see, many, many devotees have told me this. We start off with Swamiji. We like the personality of Swamiji and the work he did and all that. Then we come to Thakur. Finally, it is all Ma. So this is the natural way we proceed. Bhakti is everything. Now, once we understand this, let us go into the qualification for bhakti. Utao Thakur bole diye chen. What are the qualifications required for bhakti? I'm not going to give that long list which they give in Jnani Yoga. Shat Sampati, and I'm not going to give that kind of list, nor what they give in yoga. You know, Yama, Niyama, you must be perfect in all this. In bhakti, it is simple. Thakur bolchen, bhakta kake bole, jar mon ishwarete ache. You have prioritized God in your life. Nothing else is more important. A bhakta's life is like that. In your homes, with your family, everywhere, you give priority to spiritual things. That sanskar has come into the house so that it facilitates the mind naturally flowing towards the Lord. That is why. So a bhakta is he whose mind dwells on the Lord. And then he says, abhiman ahankar thakle hoyna. If the kacha ami is there, unripe ego is there, which wants to do this and that, become this and that, tahole hobe na. Because then it shows you have not prioritized bhakti, the Lord. So he makes it very clear, ami roop dhipite tar kripa roop jol jomena. So if you want bhakti, keep a low profile, be humble. Humility essentially means unself-conscious, not just acting humble. Not just like that. but really unself-conscious. You have understood the roots of the ego. Those roots are in the Lord, not in the world. And that is why the bhakta is humble by nature. And then Thakur says, bhakti te ki hai? Sharir, mon, pran, shab, pavitra hoye jaye. You can never know love without purity. And in fact, if there is no purity, there is no love. The whole world is talking of love. But the bhakta knows it very well. Love is directly proportional to purity. Purity leads to love. That love leads to further purity. This is how the bhakta proceeds towards the Lord. One more thing which Thakur says about the qualifications for bhakti. He says, bhaktir mane eje. Utar aishwarja ki, bhaktir aishwarja ki. He says, vivek, vairagya, sadhu sangha, satsang, that means sadhu seva, tar naam guna kirtan. These are all the things he gives. If all, you know all, what it all means. If all this is there, then this is the aishwarja of bhakti. Tar aishwarja ki, you see, he's established in all this. Bhagavan comes from the dhatu bhag, which means all these qualities put together. The highest in the transcendental level and in this world of manifestation. That is the quality of the Lord. The highest in wealth, the greatest divine wealth, the greatest success, the greatest knowledge, and most of all, intense love for the human being. All this put together. You know, when one experiences bhakti, one does not experience it in bits and pieces. He's like this and he's like, it comes together. It comes only by his grace. So when it comes, you must capture those moments. These moments come when the mind is very sattvic and usually meditative. That is why never let go of your sadhana in the name of bhakti. It comes only at that time, usually. In your meditation, you will understand the secret of bhakti. Okay, let me go a little into the secret of bhakti. How does bhakti arise in the human heart? This is also given in our bhakti shastras. Bhakti rasamrita sindhu, bhakti rasayanam, they speak of this. You know, what sparks of bhakti in the human heart? It is a dharana of bhagavad bhav. If our mind can make a dharana of the bhav of Bhagavan, then it will spark off divine love in your heart. The heart cannot remain quiet then. When you know his nature, immediately it will melt. This dravibhuta chitta characterizes, the mind will melt away. It is not like the jnani's mind, you know, it stays like the witness. The bhakta melts. So this will naturally happen if you can make a dharana of his bhav in your mind. So how elevated must be that mind if I should be able to conceive of his bhav? How should I be? See, this is the great secret of bhakti. If I can perfectly meditate on the nature of the Lord, on his bhav towards me, can I keep quiet after that? When I know his nature and his bhav, my heart will respond immediately. That is bhakti. And this comes only by his grace. How can you know him, think of him without his grace? There is that beautiful Bangla song, you know. Tumi nahi dile dekha ke tumai dekhite pae. Tumi na dakile kache sahaje ki chitta dhaye. If you do not reveal yourself, who can know you? And if you do not wish it, can my mind just rush like that towards you? And very beautiful another paragraph is there. Mone re bujhai eto tumi vakko manatito. Tabu pran vyakulito tumare dekhite chaye. I try to convince my mind so much that tumi vakyo manatito, you are beyond speech and mind and everything. But my pran is vyakul for you. It only wants to see you, your form. This is the state of bhakta. You want to see that supreme being in this particular beautiful form. See, if you cannot get rid of name and form in samadhi, there is no need of getting rid of name and form in samadhi. Just focus on the Lord. Because His mind is beyond name and form, it will lift you to that level. Just meditating on the physical form of Thakur or Ma will lift you to their state of mind. This is the secret of bhakti. So you see, it is available to us. All this knowledge is available to us. The thing is to do it. For that, the most important thing is to manufacture the sattvic mind. If we are taking in all sorts of things from the, you know, this world, a mixture of bhavs. So a bhakta is very sensitive. Only a very sensitive person can become a bhakta. So it doesn't correlate with you. So a little distance. Thakur ki bolten, kothai amra dhyan korbo, mone bone kone. A little withdrawal within and concentrating on Him there. If we can do this in a concentrated way, it will spark off bhakti in our heart. Tar bhaver dharana asha soja kaj noy. It is not easy. It comes only by His grace. We must be prepared and ready to receive that grace. We must prepare ourselves. A very sattvic, pure mind and His grace will come in. That's the preparation required of us. So bhakti is a perfect possibility in every human mind. In fact, the human heart is meant for the Lord. After all our experiences of life, this is what you will understand. This mixture, this world is a mixture of things. I want the pure essential love in itself. So I will turn towards the Lord. No bhava of this world can satisfy the bhakta. That is why He has become the bhakta. Only the Supreme can satisfy. So this is the nature of love. Ability to catch Bhagavad Bhav in our heart is the secret of bhakti. This comes only after a lot of practice. That's why never leave spiritual practice. No matter how difficult a period you're going through, only spiritual practice is the only thing which saves us. This great treasure in our heart will only come through spiritual practice, sadhana. So generating sattvic mind and waiting for Him to come into our heart through sadhana. This is what the bhakta perpetually keeps doing. He is busy doing this through all his activities. Then, let us go into some few other things which Thakur says about bhakti, which are very interesting. You see, he says, initially, the God is the magnet and the devotee is the needle. But as the bhakta proceeds in his devotion, he becomes the magnet and God becomes the needle. What does this mean? The God also wants the bhakta so much. In fact, He takes the avatar form for the sake of the bhakta. Thay na? So He wants this bhakti. Tarki rup priya bhakti, that also Thakur has said. See, God Himself has come to teach us what He wants, what He likes. Thakur ki bolchen, as a cow loves the grass mixed with oil cakes, so also gab gab kore khenai, Thakur bolchen. So also the Lord relishes the bhakti of the bhakta. Ita bhaver vishay, bhavyatita abhave ki dhurte pare. Bhaver vishay tini. Ishwar is that form of Brahman which comes bhavpurna, full of bhav, for our progress, for our enjoyment, for our love. So why should you deny Him? He comes for that. So you see, bhakti is something very, very natural to the human heart. Perfectly possible for each one of us. In fact, the human heart is meant for that. At one place, one devotee tells Thakur, suddenly is saying, this comes in Kathamrita, Thakur is saying, you know, the bhakta is like the moth. The moth is so attracted to the flame, it goes and plunges into the flame. And then the bhakta says, does that mean the bhakta dies because the flame is so fiery, it consumes the moth? And Thakur says, no. This is a very cooling, soothing, energy-giving flame. It gives all the joy to the bhakta. It gives the greatest supreme joy to the bhakta. It is that kind of a flame. soothing light of bhakti, the soothing joy of bhakti, it is all fulfilling, all satisfying. So, and that is why the bhakta merges into that flame, readily, happily. Intellectually, you must not try to understand these things. It is to be understood through spiritual practice. The way of love is like that. It must happen in our system, then only it can be understood. Then, how exactly the bhakta's mind works. It is good for us to discuss all this. The bhakta has this tendency to humanize God, isn't it? And divinize human relationships. Because, you know, if when you humanize God, you bring him close to you. There is that beautiful story of, again, of Krishna and the gopis. You know, when Krishna was in Dwarka, what it means to humanize God? When Krishna was in Dwarka, he had number of Ranis. So one day they told him with a certain amount of pique that you are our husband, okay, but all the time, whenever you are in trouble, you say Radhe Radhe. Whenever you are happy, you say Radhe Radhe. Whenever you are anxious, you say Radhe Radhe. You don't take any of our names. Then Krishna said, that is because Radha's devotion is the highest. You cannot compare that with anybody else's. And they said, how do you know? You do not know our devotion for you. How do you say Radha's devotion is the highest? Then Krishna said, okay, I will let you know why I consider her devotion to be the highest. And then after a few days, it was suddenly seen that Krishna had very severe migraine, very severe headache. He is lying down and all the symptoms of migraine, and nothing is curing the migraine, you know, 2 days, 3 days, and the migraine is not going, and all the physicians came and tried their Ayurveda, what all was available at that time. Nothing is working, and Krishna is doing, and all the Ranis or queens are very disturbed, and the courtiers, and then finally the most wise courtier came and said, see, this is also one of his leelas, I'm sure. So let us ask him only to provide the remedy, because nothing is curing him. And all the subjects were also in despair that Krishna is suffering from severe headache, migraine, what to do. So they all come to him and tell him, you only provide the solution to your problem. Tell us what is the remedy. And then Krishna said in a very sad tone, see, there is only one remedy for my problem. Bhakta pada dhuli. If that is put on my head, this migraine will go. The dust of a devotee's feet should go on my head, should be smeared here, then my migraine will go. Everybody got shocked. Now who will give padadhuli to be put on Krishna's head? They all saw him as, they knew his divinity. So they all said, you are just acting, we know. We are not going to, because giving the dust of our feet on your head will earn us eternal hell. Narak. And how can we have such a fate after so much devotion to you? So we are not going to give you the padadhuli. Everybody went away. All the queens also went away. And then Krishna said, give me a little bit, this migraine will go then. Nobody gave, none of the courtiers gave, none of the family members gave, praja, none of the subjects gave. And then Krishna said, you see, Vrindavan is not very far. Just go and ask them. And so some of the courtiers went there. As soon as they went there, all the gopis came running. And they said, how is Krishna? And he said that he is well, but just now he has migraine. And they became very serious. Can we do something about it? Cannot anybody cure him? And only one thing can cure him, that is bhakta pada dhuli. If anybody can give the dust of their feet, that can cure Krishna. At once Radha put down her odni and stepped on it, brought more sand from on her feet, stepped on it and offered that. And all the gopis did that, all the gopikas. They collected a huge amount of their padadhuli in a cloth and gave it to those courtiers and said, go immediately and apply it on his forehead. Why? He must be relieved of the headache. Doesn't matter what will happen to us. We know this will earn us eternal hell. In that eternal hell, the devotion to Krishna will be in our heart. Will that be hell? if devotion is in your heart, can you ever be in hell? Even if you are physically placed somewhere. And if devotion to Krishna is not there, this very place is hell. Aren't you seeing it? So they gave it, and these courtiers went, and then they gave it to the queens and said, see, all the gopis of Vrindavan have given this. And they applied it on Krishna's forehead, and immediately migraine went. And Krishna said, did you see? They never think of themselves. Radha never thinks of herself. One who gave even her good name, her maan, sambhram, everything for the sake of Krishna. Everything that she had. So you cannot compare her devotion to anybody's. In her mind, only I reign, nothing else. And that is why her devotion is the highest. Don't compare her with anybody. Radha used to live in Mahabhav. No ordinary state of mind, that is. Those of you who have read Thakur's life, you know very well what it means. So this is not an ordinary category of devotion at all. But it shows us the nature of devotion. Only the beloved is important. Nothing else is important. That is bhakti. So once we have understood this, let us go into the nature of the methods of bhakti. Now, how do I cultivate this bhakti? Step by step, what is the way? As we discussed, Thakur has said, Tar Naam Guna Kirtan. See, this is something which we many times don't do. Please observe this and see. We are a sort of Gnan Mishrita Bhaktas many times. But unless you speak about him, think about him, Tar Upar Charcha, Tar Naam Gunagan, Tar Upar Kirtan, unless we do this, you know, those vrittis will not be created. So that sanskar will not be created. In Chaitanya Dev's life, I was reading, when his devotees used to talk of Krishna, holding the Bhagavat, they would discuss the life of Krishna, and those pages, that bark used to get wet, the ink used to get smudged. This is how they would discuss the Leela of the Lord, the nature of Krishna. Do we discuss Thakur like that? Today we have the avatars ready incidents. Everyday life of the avatar, how he lived, what he spoke in the Kathamrit. Do we discuss Thakur like that? Is that the priority? Even when devotees meet, if you are discussing Modi government or politics or sports or something, what's the point? Discuss about the Lord, about his bhav, his nature. And you see what you are psychologically doing? Creating the bhakti vrittis. When you repeat them, they become sanskars. That is how the sanskars of bhakti, the foundation of bhakti is created. Talk about the Lord. Talk about your feeling for the Lord. Talk about his feeling for you. The incidents of his life. Nothing more purifying than that. So consciously it has to be done. Tar Naam Guna Kirtan. Then Thakur says prarthana. Prayer. Just chanting is not enough. Direct dialogue with God. On an everyday basis, if you pray intensely, one Swamiji also has said this, if you pray intensely for a few minutes, it creates a totally different atmosphere in your heart. You will be transformed in a matter of a few days if you pray intensely for a few minutes daily. Prayer is the actual power of bhakti, because you are talking with God. There your mind can't play any tricks. It can't fool itself, because you are talking with God. That is prayer. So it is to be practiced, all these disciplines. Another thing which Thakur says is sadhu sangha. The ambience you keep, the atmosphere matters a lot. Many times we become insensitive to this. You see, a completely worldly atmosphere will remove bhakti bhav. That is why bhakta should be sensitive. Deliberately, consciously come to an atmosphere which is purified, which is elevated. Now there are such beautiful temples all over the country. Utilize them. What are they meant for? Not just for Thakur sitting there, that you may go. Then he is happy. They are meant for you. The ashram is meant for you. So if you go there with this ichha to develop bhakti, then the Lord is the happiest. Tini bhaktir bhagavanto. So it is meant for that. All these accessories of bhakti are to be utilized. And that is why everyday basis prayer and satsang, going to place where there are positive vibrations. I am sure it is very clear to you. You go to a temple, you know how you feel. You go to a theater, you know how you feel. The place matters, especially in this path. So go to places where there are positive vibrations. Utilize the space. They are all consecrated spaces where daily worship is going on. So they are very pure spaces. And then another thing required for bhakti is seva vritti. Without seva, there is no love. Love is what love does. So say in bhakti shastras, they say seva vritti ashrayatva bhakti macharit. If you are thinking of love without seva, that is no love. Love means seva. So everywhere you will see, wherever bhakti is practiced, there is always seva. Through seva, you proceed in love. You proceed towards love. So this is another thing which we should know. Then, let me tell you a certain fundamental points about jnana and bhakti. You see, these are not ordinary chitta vrittis, jnana and bhakti. Bhagavad akar vritti, which is the responsible for bhakti, and brahmakar vritti, which is responsible for jnana, they are not ordinary chitta vrittis. Bhagavad akar bhakti only comes through that dravibhuta chitta under the grip of the sthayi bhava of Bhagavan. This is how it is described, bhakti. Which means it is under the grip of the bhava of Bhagavan. That is why it has melted. And the result of that is a very, very subtle, purified, great vritti in the mind, which is called bhagavadakar vritti. When that arises, you know the nature of the Lord. When you know the nature of the Lord, bhakti will spark within your heart. So these are not ordinary chitta vrittis. It comes through spiritual practice. But you should know it is a possibility with all of us. And our sadhana is meant for that, isn't it? That is why I am dwelling on the signs of bhakti. It is required to know this. One beautiful example I can give you here. You might have heard of the name of Sanatan Goswami. There's a beautiful incident in his life. How exactly this works? You see, if bhakti is there in the heart, which means dravibhuta chitta has occurred, nothing else will appear important to you. Nothing is more precious than that. One who has had that experience, that is the charam avastha. That is considered to be the very peak of human experience, human emotion. So this Sanatan Goswami used to sit for hours and hours doing his Krishna Naam every day. You know, they would do 3 lakh japas. And constantly in that mode, sitting and taking the name of the Lord. One day when he was sitting like this outside his kutiya in Vrindavan, even today they will show you that place if you go to Vrindavan. We live very close to Vrindavan, you know. So all these stories come to us. So he used to sit there outside his kutiya and doing his Harinam. One day a villager was passing by. So he saw this saint and immediately he came there. He came to Sanatan Goswami and he fell at his feet. And then he said, Maharaj, please grant me one boon. I'm in great need of money. Huh? You are such a great saint. Grant me this one boon. Grant me money. And then initially Sanatan Goswami didn't even open his eyes. He was fully soaked in Krishna. But he went on pleading. After some time he opened his eyes and he just asked like that, what? He said, I want some money, please. I'm in very urgent need. Otherwise I have to do something desperate. And then, you know what he did? He showed him a stone there. And then he said, take that and go. Just like that. And he continued with his Harinam. Then this man went there and he picked up, there was a rock-like thing under which there was a stone. Now this was the most precious stone. It was no ordinary stone. It was the Parashmani, the philosopher's stone. Which means you touch, at that time they had that knowledge of alchemy, you know. You touch that to anything, any metal, it turns into gold. So that stone, is lying there like that outside somewhere, thrown away like that. And he's telling, take that and go. So this man took that stone. As he was going back, going home, it suddenly occurred to him, look at this saint. Huh? This is philosopher's stone. This is Parashmani. It can get you everything in this on this earth. And he's thrown it out like this outside his house and telling me, take it and go. He doesn't want it. So what he must have got that he feels this is nothing. This has no value for him. And he turned back and saw Sanatan Goswami's face. And that face was drenched in tears, lit up with bhakti, full of ecstatic joy. As soon as he saw that face, he understood, what am I doing? And he came back to Sanatan Goswami, fell at his feet. And then that's very beautiful in Bangla. He says, Je dhane hoya dhani, mano na moni re moni. Getting that which, what treasure, you do not consider this to be a treasure. Give me a little of that treasure. I do not want this stone. And he threw it away like this into the Jamuna. It's right there, the Yamuna. And then he said, give me a little of this treasure which you are enjoying alone here by yourself. I do not want anything else. And then Sanatan Goswami blessed him. This is a real incident. So you see, the mind of Bhakta doesn't want anything else naturally, because so precious is this feel of bhakti. To get this little effort we have to put, isn't it? Thakur Swamiji, in his bhakti yoga, he says some of the characteristics of love he gives. Love knows no fear. You know the triangle of bhakti. Love knows no barter. We know the meaning of all this, so I won't dwell on it. And then he says, love is always of the highest ideal. This is a very significant point, the third angle of bhakti. It is always the highest ideal, so it has no competition. It has nothing to replace it. Nothing can compare with it, because it is always the highest ideal for the bhakta. So this is the triangle of bhakti. In order to gain this, there are certain fundamental laws which I would like to discuss, the science of bhakti. You see, bhakti entirely depends on your self-image, because it starts with I and you, isn't it? It's the dual mode of worship. Now, if this sense of I is not well developed, bhakti will not develop. That is why in bhakti shastras, you know, in the path of bhakti, they usually give a very elevated self-image to the practitioner. If you go to traditional Gaudiya Vaishnavites, they will actually give you a self-image. Like, say you are a Gopika, a friend of Radha, something like this. Or you are a Gop Balak who used to play with the friend of Krishna. Something like this they will give you. A self-image is required in order to relate with this, the Divine Lord. So that is why our self-image as bhaktas should be very elevated. We are devotees of the Lord. We will not give in to low thoughts, low emotions, worldly ways. Our conduct, our behavior, our speech, everything will be of a certain level. Our bhav will always be elevated. This self-image is very much required. In a very big way, identity plays a role in bhakti. That is why an elevated sense of identity. You know, the actual psychology, psycho-spiritual element in bhakti is, once Sri Ram asked Hanumanji, how do you look upon me? What was the answer Hanumanji gave? Deha buddhyatu dasosmi. As long as I am body conscious, which everyone is, so long I am your devotee. You see, the sense of identity plays a role here. As long as I am body conscious, I am your devotee or your servant, whatever relationship we form with the Lord. Deha buddhya dasosmi, jiva buddhya tadamshakaha. Atma buddhya tvamevaham iti meneshitamati. When I am not body conscious, when I am identified with my jivahood, then I am a part of you. But I am identified with the Atman, I am you yourself. So these are the three stages of evolution on this path of bhakti. This is how Hanumanji sees Sri Ram. So how much we can learn from this, you see. And then, there are three types of bhakti also, which Thakur also says in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. The sattvic bhakta, the rajasic bhakta, and the tamasic bhakta. Sattva is very much required for bhakti. It is the sattva element which actually generates bhakti. So if our mind is clouded, if the mind is confused, mind is impure, then bhakti is very difficult. So manufacturing this state of mind will lead to bhakti. Then Thakur makes another very important point. He says, you know, Sachidananda, Brahman, is like the ocean, shoreless ocean of Sachidananda. It is the shoreless ocean of Sachidananda. But due to the cooling influence of the bhakta's love, the ocean, you know, crystallizes into icebergs here and there. There are icebergs in the ocean. But when the sun of knowledge rises, this iceberg melts away. But there are places in the ocean where the icebergs don't melt. Now, very significant, this whole thing. You see, Brahman is really, the nature of God is Brahman, Satchidananda. But if you approach him with bhakti in the dual mode, he will take the form of an iceberg and relate with you. He will fill you with bhakti, fill you with love. And then, when the sun of knowledge arises, however, then what happens? The iceberg might melt away because you transcend naam roop. But for a bhakta, one who wants only bhakti, he does not want to let go of the iceberg. So for him, there are places where the icebergs don't melt. Chirantan bhaktir lok ache, where always the bhakta relates with the Lord, lives in the realm of bhakti, like Golok. There is Ramakrishna lok also, an extension of Brahmalok. So it is all there. Whatever you want, you can get. If you strive for it. If you want bhakti, you will get bhakti. If you want, after this birth, still to be a great bhakta of the Lord, soaked in bhakti, you will go into that realm. So entire thing, Thakur has made it very clear. For the bhakta, bhakti is everything. His liberation is of the nature of sarupya, samipya, isn't it? We read all this. He looks like the Lord. He starts looking even also like the Lord. That's the meaning of sarupya. The bhakta starts looking like the Lord because whatever you love, you imitate and you imbibe. You become like the Lord. So he looks also like, he looks divine, basically. And samipya, you will remain near to the Lord. Sayujya, you are in a way joined only with bhakti, with his bhav. So this is all the liberation of bhakti. Bhakti itself is liberation. Bhakti liberates the mind from all smallness. Bhakti itself is liberation. So this is the understanding of bhakti. Please remember this. The joy born of bhakti is the highest in the scale of joy available to the human experience. Because even after Brahmagnan, you know, many great people have said this, the bhakta can retain a joy, but because he has the knowledge of the Supreme, that the devotional delight born of that state which is after the knowledge of the Supreme is the greatest. In his case, the Gnan also leads to bhakti, greater. It's called parabhakti then. A great, very elevated state of bhakti. If you read Swamiji's parabhakti portion, it becomes very clear. He doesn't even need a form of the Lord. It is all within him. Let me just quote Swamiji's words here on bhakti, parabhakti. Very beautiful. See what you can get out of it. He says, object after object is taken up and the inner ideal is successively projected upon them all until all external objects are found to be insufficient exponents of the ever-increasing inner ideal and are given up as such. This is when the bhakta learns to worship the ideal as the ideal, which to him is quite alive and real. This is parabhakti. I don't know what you got out of this, but parabhakti is far transcendental state of bhakti when this normal state of vaidhi bhakti also is not required because you are seeing the ideal as the ideal and merging into it. It's all within you at that time. And no object can suffice for that. So it's a very transcendental state of bhakti. This, our daily vaidhi bhakti, will lead to that state. This is what is being said. Now, let me just point out two obstacles of bhakti. I think few more minutes we have, and we'll go into the question answer session. Just a few words about the obstacles to bhakti. What are the obstacles to bhakti? Otao Thakur bole diyechen. Tini bolchen, moner sthirata na hole jog hoy na. Mon sthir na hole jog hoy na. And moner sthiratar vyaghat kamini kanchan. Very clear cut. So if all these elements are in the mind, bhakti will not come there. The mind will not be stable. If it is not stable, neither bhakti nor jnana will come, nor discrimination. So vastu vichar, Thakur says. And practice of purification, which means I rest my senses on divine objects, on sattvic things. This is very important because the inlets to your mind are the senses, isn't it? So instead of seeing all sorts of things, seeing all sorts of movies, you will see only movies of bhaktas. You will dwell only on, rest your eyes only on sattvic things. Then the bhava produced in your mind will be sattvic. Instead of hearing all sorts of things with your ears, you will hear only devotional music, bhajans. You will associate only with devotees. Like this, if you live like this, in this kind of an ambience, the content of your mind will change. Because what you take in through the senses becomes the content of your mind. What you repeat there, those vrittis, becomes your sanskars. And your sanskars generate your memories further. This whole cycle, you control. So take in the right things. A bhakta has to be careful, even about food. A little bit of care everywhere. And cultivate the bhakti attitude in your mind. As a result, sanskars of bhakti will be formed. Memories will be purified. Once the experience of bhakti occurs, nothing can stop you. You will simply dive into the ocean of bhakti. Finally, let me conclude with one incident from Thakur's life, which is very illuminating. How exactly in our practical life we will bring bhakti. See, now we are convinced of a few things, that the goal of life is bhakti. There is a way to this. The source of bhakti is the Supreme God Himself, the Lord Himself. And there is a way for me to go towards this. In my everyday practical life, how can I bring this? Because we are doing work in the world. Most of our time goes in this work. Thakur Himself has shown it through an incident. You know, many of you have visited Dakshineshwar Temple Garden, Kali Mandir, Bhavatarini Kalimar Mandir. So there, when Vishuddhananji Maharaj, long back, many years back, when he was visiting that Kali temple, he saw an old gardener, very old man, sitting and removing those grass and small grasses, weeds which grow between rocks. He was sitting and removing in the path between Thakur's room and Panchavati. You know, there's that path paved with stones. So he used to sit there and keep removing this charagar, small tree plants and weeds and all that. And so old he was, he could hardly sit, and with his chashma he would be removing like this. And Vishuddhananji Maharaj thought, why this old man sitting in the sun doing this job? He should be resting at home. So he went and told him, Aapni kano eta korchen? Takun he said, Thakur amake bolechen. Then Maharaj thought, Thakur ki bolechen? Thakur apnake ki bolechen? So he would not tell. And then after some time, Maharaj came again, and again he was doing this. So he again told him that Thakur apnake ki bolechen. Then finally one day, this old man told him, when he was a very young man, like a teenager, when he first came into Dakshineshwar Temple Garden, it so happened he heard that this saint is there. Thakur is there in this room, and he's a man of realization. So from a distance, he used to do pranam. One night, he was very restless. It was very hot. And so he came out of his room. He was working in that temple garden. He was a worker there, like a servant. So he came out of his room just to enjoy the breeze, Ganga breeze. Ganga is flowing right there. And he came out there, and he was moving about a little because it was very hot in the room. And suddenly he saw a light in Beltala, not in Panchavati, in Beltala. And he thought, what is that light there? In those days, there were no street lights, but what, some bright light there. So he went there slowly to see what that light is. A kind of blue light was coming out. And then when he went closer and saw, Thakur was sitting under the bale tree. And from his body, that radiance of light was coming out. And Thakur was absorbed in samadhi. The sheer bliss on his face, that inward turned gaze, and the light, he was lit up as it were, so lit up that the surroundings got lit up by his light. Seeing this murti of Thakur, this boy was stunned. And then he looked at him for some time, tears came to his eyes. Then he simply fled back. He didn't know what to do. He simply turned back, went back to his room. And then that night he could not sleep after seeing this image of Thakur. Next day morning he went for work. His whole mind is only on what he saw. You see, after getting such a darshan, what will a man do? Then somehow he was doing his work. Suddenly he saw Thakur coming from the Panchavati side. Coming there. As soon as he saw Thakur, he was gripped with fear. Yesterday he was like this and today he's behaving like a normal man. He's coming like this. And that when Thakur came closer, he did a sashtang pranam to Thakur. Thakur looked at him and said, Kire aaj eto bhakti keno? And then he looked at Thakur and he could not say anything. He just kept staring. But Thakur understood. He said, oh, kalke oi murti dekhe chile? Then Thakur said, oi murti rupar dhyan korbe. Aar ei rasta parishkar rakbe. This is his instruction to us, all devotees. Meditate on that image. Meditation will bring everything into your life. If you don't meditate on the physical form of Thakur, you will not be elevated to his mental state. And keep this road clear, your path to Thakur, which is your work. Make it an offering at the feet of the divine. Shejane ei rasta parishkar rakbe. This is his instruction to all devotees through the medium of that gardener he is giving us. Meditate on him and make your work an offering at his feet. That way it will become a yoga. It will become your offering to him. And that will lead you to him. So if we can do this much, I think our bhakti sadhana will achieve fulfillment. It is my prayer today that Sri Ramakrishna bless us all with bhakti and truly fulfill our life, because bhakti is the greatest blessing which the divine can give to the jiva, to the human being. I pray that this blessing come into our lives. Thank you very much.
I would like to open the forum for any questions you all have for Mataji.
Parabhakti, little thing which you said, it was too fast.
Okay.
Everything was slower, that was too fast.
Okay.
Please, thank you.
See, let me sound a warning before I start. Vaidhi bhakti is to be followed for a long time before we even understand something of parabhakti. I will just repeat the lines here, but it's an experience. It is not to be codified in rational thought, nor is it to be understood through rational thought. It's an experience. But let's listen to what Swamiji has written. He says, object after object is taken up, and the inner ideal is successively projected upon them all until all external objects are found to be insufficient exponents of the ever-expanding inner ideal and hence are given up. This is when the bhakta derives the power, maybe I am slightly changing the words, not exactly, but this is the bhav, derives the power of worshipping the ideal as the ideal, which to him is quite alive and real. You have transcended Vaidhi bhakti, that's the meaning. You are not even attached to the form merely, but you have entered the tattva of that form, what it indicates, what it signifies. You have entered into the bhava of Bhagwan. That's why you can dispense with the object. This is what he means to say. Did it make sense? Yes?
What are those objects? The objects are all the sense objects?
No. Here he means the divine objects which you had been meditating upon, focusing your bhakti upon. Even they may be dispensed by the bhakta at these higher stages of bhakti.
As I'm asking this question, it is sounding foolish to me also. So I don't know whether I can convincingly raise my doubt. I have been reading Upanishads, Gita, little bit Brahma Sutra.
Mm.
Swamiji I have read, just to give little bit introduction. I follow Shankaracharya's commentaries and all.
Mm-hmm.
When I read, hear you, when I read about Bhakti Yogas from some other, so many saints have written, thoroughly confused. Because these two seem to be very different methodologies to be followed. One says, Jnana Yoga says something, I mean, Gyan says something different.
Yes, philosophically they are different.
But the philosophy itself, I take it further.
Mm.
Emotions can be very misleading.
Mm.
So unless I understand what God is, how can I be in love with God? I can be loved with an idea. I cannot be loved with that. Maybe whole of my this life I'll be following just an idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I might be just following certain emotions which may not be true.
Mm-hmm. She has raised a beautiful question actually. Yeah,
so
yeah, very good.
How does one resolve after following a spiritual life and taking Diksha after 20 years? Still this question remains.
This is pretty obvious. Emotion cannot be trusted unless it is elevated to a particular level. That's why I spoke on purity. Otherwise emotion is not at all reliable. It will mislead you. That's why the path can become very strange. If you try to practice bhakti with an impure mind, it will lead you nowhere. It is dangerous actually. And in today's society, that creates all the more difficulty, you know, single parent families where you the child doesn't know the father and we are telling him, well, God is the father. Maybe he doesn't like his father. How is he going to see God as father? All these practical problems are happening. That is why bhakti yoga, you have to practice it in a particular way with a certain elevation of emotion. If that is not happening, if I'm not able to muster that level of emotion, better to follow a path which I can do. That is why many people are turning to Jnana Yoga. But that will not get you success in Jnana Yoga unless emotion is purified. Because you know, all our faculties move together. You cannot be purely intellectual and completely bereft of emotion. You can't be. So, what do we do? Cultivate your emotion. If you can't, if it doesn't agree with the world, if it can't come in terms to the world, cultivate it in some other way. There are ways to do it. Through the practice of bhakti, you can elevate emotion gradually, even as you practice your intellectual analysis. And together you can bring these three and practice.
Thakur says that for Kali Yuga, bhakti is there. But don't we feel with our experience, maybe at a lower level experience, that actually it's very difficult to cultivate the idea of, not idea of God, God is the reality, it's not an idea. To follow the Bhakti Bhakta, I mean, I'm just giving little bit of personal this thing. I started my Vedanta studies through Vivekananda Mataji. She never spoke on Bhakti. We requested, she said, no, this yoga is not, you don't have the faith. So this yoga, I'm talking about practical things, we don't have faith. So we never spoke on Bhakti. Swamiji's Bhakti Yoga, we never studied.
No, see, if you don't have faith, you can take to other paths.
She generalized
but
that.
But you lose the beauty of life,
maybe.
Which is love.
Yes. So jnana doesn't give love.
No, I'm not saying jnana doesn't give love. It will give you love for something impersonal and abstract. Yes, the sweetness of love which bhakti gives. If you want to taste that rasa, then try to cultivate a certain amount of, I won't say faith, but a certain amount of elevated emotion. Right within yourself, first try to do that. Because I know usually bhakti is hampered because of wrong types of relationships, which are happening very commonly in today's world, which the bhakta shudders from. That is why it is difficult to develop bhakti. You know, that's why I said a little distance from worldly bhavs is required. Gradually, step by step, you have to build up bhakti. You see, the purity of the human heart is meant for the Lord. You are meant for the Lord. Why should you give in to all this? If we have got sort of conditioned into wrong emotions, coming out of it can be very difficult. That is why we find bhakti difficult. but you have to try to do it. Otherwise, you lose a beautiful chunk of human experience, isn't it? I am not saying Advaita will not give love. I am not saying that. It is love towards an impersonal ideal. Bhakti is always towards a personal ideal. You know, Ramana Maharshi used to say, Bhakti is Jnana Mata. Bhakti is the mother of even Jnana. I must lead a pure life, then everything becomes possible. That is the actual thing. So strive for that. Doesn't matter if the world does not give me the right bhavs. Well, why should it matter? Today's world, everybody is independent, you know. So it doesn't matter. Associate with bhaktas and bhakti will grow.
I am a student of literature, and constantly it's being pointed out to me that you will never understand the logic behind spirituality, because you're all heart. You understand things which are poetic. You understand, and I'm being told this by my husband. So he's not here, but I say that in front of him. He tells me you'll never understand the logic of spirituality. There is a science to it. And I really don't get it.
Well, I don't agree with him. I agree with
you. I'm happy. Yes. So, but then, as I said, if there is no jnana, the ocean of bhakti will just suck you in. It will lead you nowhere. You'll be just, that's what the logic.
No, you see, the point is this. It's not that if you have devotion, you will not have a rational intellect. That is not true. In fact, your rational intellect only will show you how important emotion is. This elevated emotion, I'm not talking of worldly bhavs at all. Not the silly, bartery relationship between people. I'm not talking of that. I make you happy and you make me. Is there any meaning in that? It's simple barter, it's business. It has no spiritual value. I am talking of elevated emotion. Your rational intellect itself will tell you that this is a really covetable thing in human life. Bhakti is the joy and bliss of human life. Who can dispense with it? No jnani has been able to live it out. See the life of realized souls. That is the best way to find the way in our own lives. See their lives. See the life of Shankaracharya. The best hymns which we are chanting before our gods. Your Ganesh Puja happened just now. Some of the best hymns of Hinduism are all in a devotional fervor. Shankaracharya, the great Advaitin, gave it out. I told you the story of Madhusudan Saraswati, Ramana Maharshi, Swamiji, Thakur, overflowing with bhakti. Who can do without bhakti? You must learn to elevate emotion. There is no other way. That is why these worldly bhavs, which suck away your energy actually, and which make you feel, well, emotion is simply misleading. They make you feel like that. So that has to be simply removed from your life if you want spiritual elevation through bhakti.
Yes, Mataji. So then there is hope.
Yes, absolutely.
There's hope that without understanding the intricacies of philosophical thoughts, a person like me who can get sucked in, will find some way.
See, getting sucked into real bhakti is liberation. Don't think you're getting lost somewhere. And this rational, logical thinking can make you just a philosopher also without experience. It is quite possible. Because jnana also is actually an experience. It happens within you. It happens in you. It's a mystical experience. Advaita is an experience. You just know what the real I is. By no process of rational thought, you can come to that point. It can at the most take you towards that. That is the thing. So in both the paths, there can be mistakes, you know. Both the paths can mislead, actually. Advaita is not a mere philosophy. It is an experience. To one to whom it has happened, it's an experience. Then he may try to put it in logical ways to convince you, but to him it was an experience.
Mataji, I've got two questions actually. One is about relationship with God. Mm-hmm. So Sudama felt himself like a friend of Krishna. But for me, sometimes I feel relationship one with God, and sometimes I have relationship two with God, depending on my circumstance of my life.
Okay.
Like when I'm not very prosperous, I remember Sudama. And when I'm like in a very, I remember the goodness of Krishna. So I'm confused whether I'm with one state or with multiple relationships with God are possible or not in bhakti. So.
Yeah, why not multiple relationships? Why should they not be possible? But the thing is, you are aiming at the realization of one particular bhav in bhakti.
Yeah.
You want to see God as mother or friend or whatever, isn't it? Yeah. So you take up just one relationship. But of course, when you are feeling very sisterly, you can consider God as brother. When you are feeling very motherly, you can consider him as child. Why not? You can put all your bhavas on him.
And the second question is that the spiritual practices, you know, bhakti requires a lot of material like flowers, and it requires a lot of dravya also. And depending on the situation, the time and all, and the financial capacity at times, we cut short spiritual practices, sometimes we extend them. Of course, meditation is there always, but it's just, you know, connected with God. We have different types of spiritual practice, sometimes aartis and all that we do. But what happens is, sometimes we cut short, sometimes we expand. Then we feel, are we progress? Are we, when we cut short, we feel as if, are we doing injustice to our practices or something of that kind?
No, the essential thing is to give the love of your heart to the Lord. These other things are accessories.
Okay.
If you have the means, do them. If you have the time, do them. It's okay if you don't do them also. But the love of your heart should flow to the Lord. This is the essential thing. Constantly that bhav should flow towards the Lord.
Thank you.
That is the point.
Mataji, I have a question associated with bhakti and sharanagati. Are they correlated? And how do you have faith in God? I mean, when you often tend to offer your situations to God, when does sharanagati come? Let me put it like this.
When does sharanagati come? Sharanagati comes when you have exhausted all your energies in doing all that you can to move towards the Lord. Then you know still you are not progressing or not moving forward, then you just take refuge in Him. But your initial question was, how do we have faith in the Lord? Isn't it?
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
How do we have faith in the Lord? You see, faith comes, just see how a baby develops faith in his mother. How does he develop? The continuous pouring of love from the mother heart and the perception of that by the child as he grows up, that creates the bond, isn't it? Now God is constantly pouring love on you. You are not understanding, you are not perceiving it. That is the problem. Look at the bounties of your life. Getting a healthy body, a healthy mind, a good family, a good education, everything has come together in your life. And you have an inquiring mind. You want to know about bhakti. You must be able to perceive God's love, grace in all of this. Wanting to know about bhakti itself is such a big manifestation of grace. So grace is always there. You must be able to perceive that grace. For that, a sensitive mind is required. Spiritual practice is required. Once you bring your mind into that super sattvic state, where you are able to perceive the love of God for you, bhakti will spark off by itself. This is how you develop real faith in the Lord. You see, it's a secret thing. Whatever is secret, isn't it? Huh? We don't talk openly of faith and love and all that. Why? It is so precious. It's my little secret in my heart. It is something of me given to the Lord. So it is like that, it has to be cultivated secretly, not openly. Bhakti is not in what you do. Bhakti is the feeling you are giving the Lord. Isn't it? So that has to be cultivated little by little, step by step.
And when you say purity, pure love.
Yes.
I know we read it all in the books, but would you elaborate on that? Shuddha bhakti.
Yes.
Shuddha prem.
Yes. You see, shuddha bhakti means the mind level, the chitta vrittis are continuously flowing towards the Lord. There is absolutely no distraction in that mind. It does not even want to turn towards anything else. You saw that Sanatan Goswami's condition does not even want to turn towards anything else. This is shuddha bhakti. Nothing else is important, nothing else is pulling that mind. When does this bhakti come into our life? When we have had so much experience in vaidhi bhakti, means the preliminaries of bhakti, that our mind is convinced this is the most covetable thing in life. So much of joy and bliss has filled your heart that you know only this is my goal. Then shuddha bhakti enters your heart. So we proceed step by step. A little experience of bhakti today, a little more tomorrow, bringing in more of the things required to manufacture bhakti. As you go on working like this day after day, keeping aside worldly bhavs, which can create havoc in your mind, keeping them aside as you work on bhakti, one day you will understand your mind is simply rushing towards the Lord. You are absorbed. Absorption is a sign of shuddha bhakti. You are absorbed in the Lord. Nothing else is more important. This is the nature of shuddha bhakti.
Pranam Mataji, I like to say that for all and everything, the faith should be constantly there in the mind.
Yes.
And that will elevate the mind towards the Lord one day, definitely.
Yes, yes.
That is the thing.
Yes.
Thank you, Mataji. Yes. Pranam to you.
Bhaktas practice this in so many ways, you know. Every little thing they do, they will say, Jai Ma, Jai Thakur, Jai Krishna, something they will. Just to remind their minds, God is here. You see, by whose power are we working?
Yeah.
Your own physiology, you see, is your heart beating with your permission? Or your lungs functioning through your will? By whose power is everything working? God is ever manifest in His creation. You and I are not able to see. That's our problem.
Yeah, Mataji.
Mataji has given us a very holistic picture on almost every aspect of bhakti. And when I came in, I had so many questions. And I am now even more curious to learn more and practice more of this. So thank you for your valuable thoughts and your time.